Good evening. It's good to have you all gather in the Lord's house for worship this evening. This weekend marks the end of a church season. This is the last Sunday in Epiphany. Epiphany means revealing. Jesus has been revealed in his words and miracles as the Son of God and our Savior. And we're going to have one last miracle tonight that's a part of Epiphany, which is the Transfiguration. This Sunday, tomorrow, is also called Transfiguration Sunday, where Jesus, for a moment, let the veil down from his humanity, and he glowed with light as the Son of God. It's one of the more powerful and amazing miracles. I'll be speaking about that in the sermon tonight, and you'll hear about it in the scripture readings. The glory of God, so important in our lives. We'll follow the order of worship that is service of the Word. I have it laid out for you in the service folder. It will also be on the screens. We'll begin with the singing of the first hymn. We'll sing the five stanzas of hymn 95, How Good, Lord, to Be Here. Please rise. Page 2 in the service. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
We have come into the presence of God who created us to love and serve him as his dear children, but we have disobeyed him and deserve only his wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to him and plead for his mercy. We'll join together. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me, according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all of your sins by the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ. He has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to His will. Amen. In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Oh, taste. Let us pray. Lord God, before the suffering and death of your one and only Son, you revealed his glory on the holy mountain. Grant that we who bear his cross on earth may behold by faith the light of his heavenly glory, and so be changed into his likeness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. The first reading for this Sunday, for this weekend, is written in the Old Testament book of Exodus, chapter 34, starting with verse 29. A very strange circumstance. The introduction goes like this. Moses comes down from Mount Sinai with the Ten Commandments, his face shining, and the people were afraid. Moses calls to him and speaks God's commands. When he's done, we hear that he covered his shining face with a veil. When Moses came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the testimony, that's the Ten Commandments, in his hand, he came down from the mountain. Moses did not realize that the skin of his face was shining because he had been speaking with the Lord. When Aaron and all the people of Israel saw Moses, they were amazed that the skin of his face was shining, so they were afraid to come close to him. Moses called to them. So Aaron and all the rulers of the community returned to him, and Moses spoke to them. Afterwards, all the people of Israel came close to him, and he gave them all the commands that the Lord had spoken to him on Mount Sinai. When Moses was finished speaking with them, he put a veil over his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out again. And then he would come out and tell the people of Israel what he had been commanded. Whenever the people of Israel saw Moses' face, they would see the skin of Moses' face was shining. Then Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with the Lord again. This is the word of the Lord, the first lesson from God's word. We'll join in the singing of the hymn tonight, hymn 284. Precious is the book divine, by inspiration given, bright and alert, its doctrination, and our souls to heaven, its light descending from above. second lesson from God's Word, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 7 and following. We're going to hear why Moses covered his face now. The introduction, the law given through Moses had glory. It was from God and expressed His holy will. However, the glory was fading because it convicts us of sin and brings condemnation. The Holy Spirit works through the glorious gospel of Jesus. This is a glory that never fades because it is our salvation. However, Paul warns we can't see this glorious salvation in the law of Moses, only in Christ. If the ministry that brought death, which was engraved in letters on stone, that's the commandments, came with glory, so that the Israelites could not look directly at the face of Moses because of the glory of his face, though it was fading, how will the ministry of the Spirit not be much more glorious? For if the ministry that brought condemnation has glory, the ministry that brought righteousness has even more glory. In fact, in this case, what was glorious is no longer very glorious because of the greater glory of that which surpasses it. Indeed, if what is fading away was glorious, how much more is glorious is that which is permanent. Therefore, since we have this kind of hope, we act with great boldness. We are not like Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the Israelites could not continue to look at the end of the radiance as it was fading away. In spite of this, their minds were hardened. Yes, up to the present day, the same veil remains when the Old Testament is read. It has not been removed, that is, from their hearts, because it takes away only in Christ. Instead, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. But of all of us who reflect the Lord's glory with an unveiled face are being transformed into His own image, from one degree of glory to another. This too is from the Lord, who is the Spirit. This is the Word of God, the second lesson. Alleluia. A voice came from the cloud. This is my Son whom I love. Listen to Him. Alleluia. We sing. Alleluia. 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 These words are written Please rise for the gospel. The words about our Lord now and for this Transfiguration Sunday, Luke chapter 9, verses 28 to 36. In verse 20 of chapter 9, Jesus asks, "Who do people say that I am?" Here in verse 28 and following, Jesus' glory is revealed. The Heavenly Father identifies Jesus as His beloved Son, whom He has chosen to rescue us from the slavery of sin and death. About 8 days after He said these words, Jesus took Peter, John, and James and went up on the mountain to pray. While He was praying, the appearance of His face changed and His clothing became dazzling white. Just then, two men, Moses and Elijah, were talking with Him. They appeared in glory and were talking about His departure, which He was going to bring to fulfillment in Jerusalem. Peter and those with him were weighed down with sleep. But when they were completely awake, they saw His glory and the two men standing with Him. As the men were leaving Jesus, Peter said to Him, "Master, it's good for us to be here. Let us make three tents, one for You, one for Moses, one for Elijah." But he did not realize what he was saying. While he was saying these things, a cloud came over and overshadowed them. They were afraid as they went into the cloud. Then a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my Son, my chosen one. Listen to him." After the voice had spoken, they found Jesus alone. They kept this secret and told no one in those days any of the things they had seen. This is the word of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. We'll join in the singing of hymn 97, Down from the Mount of Glory.
Down from the Mount of Glory came Jesus Christ our Lord. Recall the wondrous store, rich gem in sacred word. Again your faith will him in double glory. The greater homage to him will in your life appear.
grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus. Amen. The Word of God for our meditation is the Gospel reading of Jesus and that you heard read. And so let us begin with a prayer tonight. Dear Lord, help us to see your glory, that we might reflect that glory in our lives to help others. And bless our faith tonight as we listen to your word, and bless my voice. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Dear people who see the glory of Jesus. I don't know if you're aware of this. I had forgotten about it and happened to remember it while I was writing my sermon. Time magazine, a U.S. publication, has for years done a thing where they have the person of the year. And I kind of forgot what it was about, and I read a little bit, and it's not an award. It's just simply somebody who's really made the news, somebody who's been important or at least influential, man, a woman, a group. They have different ways of doing it, but ultimately, I guess you get your face on the cover of Time magazine. I didn't even know who had won in recent years until I went in connection with the sermon, just checked real quick. I mean, presidents have been on the cover many times. It'd be for the importance that they've had in the last 12 months of the year that just passed. This one would be 2021. I don't subscribe, I don't really follow it, but I thought it was interesting because this came to my mind as I was writing my sermon, thinking about it. If we Christians, believers, picked the person of the year, who would we pick? We'd pick Jesus every year, wouldn't we? I mean, he's the most important, most influential in our lives every single day of our life forever. Jesus would be the person of the year for us. That would be easy. In the Word of God for today, in the Gospel reading, Luke chapter 9, we catch a glimpse of why Jesus is so important and influential. We catch a glimpse of his glory as the Son of God, and it is breathtaking. It is amazing what we see here. In fact, I would say words can describe him, but they really aren't enough. Thankfully, we have the words of the Heavenly Father, who tells us that Jesus is his beloved Son, and he's the one that God chose to be the Savior of the world. And this is really where Jesus' glory is. As we look at chapter 9, verses 28 and following, we have this thought, see the glory of the chosen Jesus. We don't always understand what God does, and the disciples were going to have a really rough time understanding what Jesus was doing in Jerusalem when everything happened to him, including his death. And that's why it was a great help to them, and now it's a help to us today to see Jesus' glory. It's very important in our lives, and we do see it. So, earlier in the chapter 9, Jesus asked the question, who do people say that I am? And that question has been asked through the centuries, who is Jesus? And in verse 28, what makes these verses unique is that the Heavenly Father is giving an answer to that question. And one of the things does is he has this powerful miracle that the disciples see and that is described to you and me. We have the description in the Bible. Jesus' glory is there on the mountain. And how do you describe it? I've got a painting from Karl Bloch. Sounds like an Englishman, I'm not sure. But 1865 about it when he was painting this. It says in Luke, his face changed. And his clothing became dazzling white. The reason I brought this painting is I thought, well, this is kind of neat. It's hard to imagine. Jesus is in the middle there. I don't know if you can see it on this screen so well, but on either side is a man, and Jesus is in the middle, and they're just radiant with light. They're dazzling. It's the glory of God that was being projected, and that's what the artist tried to emulate there. Where we're seeing Jesus as the Son of God. Now, one of the things that I would say, first of all, this is very real, and this is Jesus, But also, please don't think that this is the only way that he has glory. Think about it. A person, a policeman, a fireman rescues somebody. It's a heroic deed. And what do? We give praise. We say, wow, that was really good. That was great. We use words of praise to describe people when they've done something good. Jesus deserves that kind of glory too, with words where we praise him. We talk about the good things that Jesus does. Now, here's the thing. Jesus' glory in his ministry was usually hidden. People looked at him and he looked like an ordinary man. I mean, he wasn't shining. This is the only time in his ministry that he shined like this. And not everybody praised Jesus, although he did. He healed a lot of people, cast out demons. He was worthy of great praise, but not everybody was willing to give him that praise. And so I think when we study the Bible, when you read the Bible, it's always good to ask questions. And there's a question that is very much in the Word here, or that we see in the Word, and that is why? Why did Jesus hide his glory? Wouldn't it have been easier if he just walked around as the Son of God, shining all the time? No, that's not the way that God the Father wanted it. And we're going to especially address that question when we get to part two. We talk about the work that Jesus did and where his glory was really hidden. The thing that I want to focus on right now, where we have this miracle in front of us, where Jesus was transformed and he shined with light, is the importance for you and me. What does it mean? Well, remember that there were three disciples, or the apostles actually, up on the mountain with Jesus. They're in the painting, Peter, James, and John. They have their backs to us. God the Father wanted them to see this. He wanted them to remember that Jesus had this glorious side to him because of what was coming. And I also want to tell you that it was really good. How do we know that? Peter says, you know, Peter was never one to be quiet. Oh, Lord, it's good for us to be here. In fact, I want to stay here, Lord. Let's make three little tents, almost like three little museums or places where you guys can, Moses and Elijah and Jesus can stay, and we can enjoy this all the time. And the Bible says, the Holy Spirit says, he didn't know what he was saying. He was confused because this was not God's plan. Nevertheless, the glory of God was good. And so I hope you're thinking, I want to see the glory of God. I want God's glory in my life. And you have it. Where is the glory of God today? It's in the church. I'm going to take you to a passage from the Old Testament, Isaiah chapter 60. It's the first three verses. I'm going to read that for you. It's on your screen. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is dawning upon you. Look, darkness covers the earth, and deep darkness covers the peoples. But the Lord will dawn upon you, and his glory will be seen over you. Nations will walk to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. You might look around the room here, the sanctuary, and go, where's the glory? I don't see it. The glory is in the Word when we have those scripture readings. You're hearing about Jesus, and when I'm talking about him right now, I'm trying to picture it for you, and hopefully to some extent you capture that picture in your mind, and you say, okay, this is the glory of Jesus. He's God. He loves me, and so on. But it's also there in the forgiveness of sins, in God's love for you, in holy baptism, the sacrament, and in the Lord's Supper when we celebrate that at the altar. The glory of the Lord is there because he is saying to you, I love you. I forgive your sins. I am with you and helping you. That is the glory of the Lord for us. Remember the words of the psalm writer. Some of you would remember this. It's a great passage in Psalm 119. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. God lightens our day in many ways, and it's very good, especially when the light of the gospel is shining. And one of the wonderful places where that really happens regularly is here in church as we worship together. Okay, some thoughts for you and I to take home as you're living through the week. How does this light, or what I'm hearing here, benefit me? One of the things, remember in verse 32, it says they were falling asleep. Jesus was praying. He was being really holy. And I think he was praying for quite a while. Well, what did they were like kids. They're adults, but they were like, after a while, they were like, okay, you know, and they were tired from hiking up the mountain. And so they started falling asleep. They almost missed the show. They almost missed the miracle. I hope that when you come to church, first of all, even before you get here, that you go, oh, I'm too tired. I'm too sleepy. I don't know if I can make it to church. Or when you get here, you drag yourself in the pew and, you know, I did see somebody once years ago sleeping in the pew at church. I suppose if you're going to fall asleep, what better place to sleep than church? You're in God's house. But the point is it's better if you and I are here and are able to see the glory of God as I preach, as we do. It's in the liturgy too. It's one of the reasons we use the liturgy from the hymnal that we do is because you see the glory of God, as Jesus is mentioned there, the forgiveness of sins and all those things. And that is so important for your life and my life. Why? Because you and I have troubles. And sometimes those troubles get us down. And we need to be strong in our faith. Or when persecution hurts us, we go, wow. You know, we don't want to walk away from our faith. And in fact, what Jesus does when he shows us his glory in the gospel, he's strengthening our faith. He's helping us to make our stand. He is ensuring that that we follow him. And that's why the gospel light, the glory of the gospel, the good news about Jesus is so important for you and for me. I mentioned that question earlier, who Jesus asked, who do people say that I am? Who is Jesus? The Heavenly Father answered that with a miracle. Now he's actually going to answer that with words. He says, this is my son whom I love. Another translation there is, this is my son whom I've chosen. I liked them both so much. I'm using both tonight. Jesus, or God the Father, loved Jesus because he sent him to be our Savior. And that's exactly what Jesus was doing. And when the Father said, this is the one I've chosen. He's my guy. He is going to win your salvation. And it's especially in the work of Jesus that we see the glory in what he accomplished. Jesus is talking about what he's going to be doing, but not with Peter, James, and John. They weren't quite up to listening to a lesson at this point in time. They hid their faces. But Jesus is talking with Moses and Elijah. It says there in English about his departure. But another way to translate the word departure is Exodus. And immediately, you know, he's talking with Moses about the Exodus. What do you think of? Egypt. Moses was God's leader, the rescuer who brought the slaves out of Egypt by the power of God, by the miracles that God performed. That was his glory there. And he brought them out of slavery into the freedom and their homeland, the promised land of Canaan. The Lord took them there with Moses. They identified Moses as their hero. Now, Jesus is going down to Jerusalem for his exodus. And he is talking with Moses about his sufferings and death for sin. That's very much. Do you have your days, let's say again, if you're sick or you're not doing well, where you doubt the glory of the Lord? I know you might not think of it that way, but when you say, hey God, where are you? What are you doing? You're doubting who he is. You're doubting his glory. Again, if there's troubles in your life, things aren't going well, financial means aren't working out, people in the family are having problems, you might say, hey Lord, where are you? We've got to be careful, because we could be really doubting the glory of the Lord. The Lord says, I'm your glorious God. I can do anything. I'm your Savior. I can accomplish what I need to do. And you and I have to say, Lord, I'm sorry. I shouldn't complain. I shouldn't grumble. I shouldn't worry about things. You know that you and I do. And then you and I say to ourselves, we need forgiveness. And that is exactly what Jesus came for. The glorious work of Jesus was to bring us the forgiveness of sins. And when the Father speaks here, what he is doing is he is putting his stamp of approval on Jesus. Because would there ever be a greater moment to doubt Jesus than when he was in Jerusalem and they put him on trial and they beat him and they took him out and they crucified him? The disciples were beside themselves. This wasn't the plan. This isn't what they thought. We're going to hear about all of that in the Lenten season, especially on Wednesday nights coming up starting this next Wednesday, Ash Wednesday. We're going to look at what we call our Savior's passion. He desired to suffer and die for us, and he did. And that brings you and I the forgiveness of sins we need. He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven. The Father said, yep, this is, he accomplished his goal. When you bring your sins to the Lord, he assures you every one of them has been taken away. Never again will those sins trouble you in the sense that God's going to call you to account. He forgets about them. They're gone. Jesus paid for them. And now you are saved and you get to join Jesus in glory. Not right now, although we do enjoy his glory in our lives, but especially when we leave this earth, we get to enter glory and share in the glory of Jesus. It was a glorious work indeed that he did. We are told that when this whole thing was over, the disciples didn't say anything to anybody about it. And that was Jesus' idea. He hadn't died on the cross yet. If they started talking about that, people were going to get the wrong message. And so they didn't say anything till after his death and resurrection about the transfiguration. After that, they spent the rest of their lives talking about the glory of Jesus and what he did and how he brought salvation to the world. You and I, well, we're past the crucifixion and resurrection. We don't have to remain silent. In fact, our Lord does not want us to. He wants us to speak in a world that is filled with darkness. You know, people run around, maybe not necessarily you or I, but they're looking for glory, and glory fades. You know, think about it. Do you know who the person of the year, it used to be called man of the year, 30 years ago, 40 years ago? I don't remember. Probably saw it one time or another when I was in a library or something. Oh, there's a maggot, oh, there's a person of the year. I don't remember. The glory fades here. Nothing on earth lasts. But you and I have a glory that has been given to us by God's grace in Jesus that is going to last forever. You have something to talk about, something to share with others. I want to share a little story with you, that has something to say to this particular point. I had a man in class here at Shepherd of the Valley years ago. His man's name was Henry. He's middle-aged, well-spoken, pretty sharp individual. He had a big tan. You know, it comes with delivering the mail. He had a career as a mailman. He was delivering mail while I was teaching him. And we went through the classes, and he had a lot of questions. He was a good guy. And I thought when we got to the end of the classes, I said, boy, Henry, you know, this is good. Do you have any questions? Love to have you join our church. You're sure welcome to if you want to. And he said, Pastor, no, I'm going to decline. I don't. And he did a couple things that he talked to me about. But he said, I want to tell you this. And I remember this to this day. He, with a big smile on his face, he said to me, I want to thank you. I have never studied the Bible this way before. Seen so much, learned so much. He was so great. He says, I will remember this. And so we went our separate ways. I don't know what happened with Henry, but I do pray that Henry and people like him continue to have the light of Jesus in their lives through the Word. And I am very thankful, and this is what I want you to be, thankful that I had the opportunity to shine the light of Jesus in his life for a little while, for a few weeks. That may happen to you, that you witness for the Lord, you share your faith. Might only be for a moment, it might be for a while, and then that person's gone from your life for one reason or another. You don't get a chance to talk again. That's okay. In your words, in your actions, Let the grace and the glory of God shine in the humility, in the Christian love, in the kindness and compassion that you show. You're reflecting the light of Jesus, and that is important. You know, I was thinking about it, and maybe you can share your thoughts with me afterwards. I was wondering, why does Time Magazine do this? And I believe there are other persons of the year. It seems to me at one time I heard they have something. Why would people do this? And my thought was, well, maybe this does attract attention. Why? Because we want to feel we're important. We want to feel we have a little bit of influence. And it's nice to measure ourselves against, you know, who's world famous, who's nationally famous. Now, I don't think that you and I have any ideas that we're going to be world famous or influential or even influential on the national level. But we want to feel important and influential with our family, our friends, the people we know. It's a kind of a human instinct, I think. You are important. First of all, because you happen to not only know, but you are connected to the most important and influential person in history. That's Jesus. He's the guy of the year, the savior of the year, every day. That never changes. Jesus loves you so much. He went through a great deal of suffering, as we're going to hear in the Lenten season, to bring you into glory. It's kind of hidden right now. Can't see it, but you will one day. And he loves you. He and the Father are constantly watching over you as you go through troubles and difficulties in your life. But you are important, and he wants you to know that. You are important as his child. You are influential. He wants you to speak as his witnesses today, or even again, just in the way we live, in the way we carry ourselves, that we reflect his love, his humility, his kindness, his compassion. We can do that in a dark world. And like with that man Henry that I told you about, sometimes it's very, very welcome. Think about that. See the glory of the chosen Jesus and what it means for you. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Jesus, our glorious Savior. Amen. We join in confessing our faith in the triune God. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We have our offering plates in the entryway of the sanctuary. You may give your offering there. Those who are at home are invited to send in their offering. We'll continue with the prayers this evening. I do want to mention that we are going to, again, we had them before, but have a prayer for the people of Ukraine, Eastern Europe, the whole region, as there's conflict there. Pray for the safety, and we have at least one family in our church who knows people there, a former exchange student who's like family. We'll mention her name. And then also we have a number of Christian churches, and there's probably just a lot of Christians in Eastern Europe. We pray for their well-being, that the Lord is with them and the people there too. So we'll pray. We begin with a prayer for Transfiguration Sunday. Heavenly Father, on the mountain you revealed Jesus Christ in his unveiled divine majesty and gave a wonderful testimony out of the cloud. You declared him your Son, whom you love. Help us always to believe and confess that Jesus is God, to the glory of your name. In commanding us to hear your Son, you have placed your divine blessing on all that he has spoken. Grant us grace to hear his wonderful words of salvation in the words of Scripture with steadfast faith, so that we do not dread his final coming or fear his judgment. Gracious Father, to know Christ by faith is to know your love, to possess your forgiveness, and to share with all the saints the hope of everlasting life. We pray for the efforts of every Christian and ourselves, our church, to spread the gospel, the glorious gospel of Jesus. Help us to share the light of salvation in a dark world, dear Lord. And bless not only us, but other churches, our missionaries around the world. May they share the good news of Jesus. We are thankful, dear Lord, that Lee Jordan is able to be with us tonight after prostate surgery. We pray for a continued speedy recovery, that he gets back to normal. We pray for the others on our prayer list, including we ask, O Lord, that you would be with Christian brothers and sisters in Ukraine, in the region, people in many places who may suffer from the conflict that is ongoing, and a special request for Olga Shava and her young son and husband, a former exchange student from Ukraine, and just all the people there, Lord. We pray for peace. We pray for healing. We pray for protecting and watching over your people and the people there. Bless them. We pray that things would go better, and again, that you would work things out. We know that you are powerful and glorious, and that you always hear and answer our prayers. Also, Lord, help the gospel to be spread there and in many parts of the world where there are conflicts, that our pastors and teachers are able to continue preaching and teaching. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus, our Savior, and we'll take a moment of silence to offer up our personal requests and prayers. We pray all of these prayers in Jesus' name. And now we join together in praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. We'll join in the singing of the hymn, Beautiful Savior.
Son of God.
And we pray. O Lord God, our Heavenly Father, pour out the Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us strong in your grace and truth. Protect and comfort us in all temptation. Bestow on us your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with one another, and serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
Please be seated. We'll sing the closing hymn. Hymn 326, May the Grace of Christ Our Savior.
May the grace of Christ Our Savior and the Father's boundless love with the Holy Spirit's favor resting on us from above. So may we abide in union with each other and the gathered here in blessed communion by the power of his word. With all the saints in heaven, thanks and praise to you.
Good evening to all. We're glad that you're here. We welcome our visitors, invite you to come again. Please sign our guest book in the entryway before you leave if you haven't done so. We have, my classes are meeting now. Pastor Spavacek's Bible classes will not meet during Lent, I believe. That's what I know Tuesday and Wednesday are not meeting. We will have Ash Wednesday service with Holy Communion this coming Wednesday, and we'll have a rotation of pastors. I haven't published the list, but I will do that with Ash Wednesday. From our local churches, we'll be visiting. I'll be here the first time, and then I'll be gone to visit the other churches. And that's really, I will do a little bit on Sundays, but it's really on Wednesday nights when we cover the Passion of Jesus and everything that happened from his betrayal to his burial. So please join us for those services on Wednesday night. If you cannot drive in the dark or don't wish to do that, we do have 4 o'clock service at Our Savior in Sun City as an option that we encourage. Or if you have other things going on, that's an option. And then finally, besides the announcements in the bulletin, which we invite you to take home, is the open forum and voters meeting. It's a month late due to my being ill in January, but we have the annual voters meeting. We'd love to have everyone come beforehand to the open forum. There isn't a lot of big news for our church, but we have reports. We'll be talking about things that are going on in our church, and in the voters meeting we have elections for this year. So those are the announcements. If you have any questions, I'll be out in front visiting with you. You can ask. Have a great week in the Lord.